our tax levies come in, of course, June and December, so we received those last month. That was $1,902,282.57. Our expenses, which were our debt service payments that we paid out for, our payments were $1,569,400.33, leaving us with a balance of $1,737,774.55 for debt service. Capital projects fund started with $451,333.42. We had $877,824.93 worth of receipts. Again, tax levies that we received for June. Expenses for the month were $45,992.57, leaving us a balance of $1,283,165.78. Transportation fund started with $694,816.86. Receipts for the month, $439,169.03. Expenditures for the month were $39,645.76. Leaving an ending cash balance of $1,094,340.13. And last but not least, bus replacement fund, $233,946.82 is what we started with. We had $112,487.96 worth of receipts, and no expenses for the month as of yet. And we've got an ending balance of $346,434.78. Are there any questions on any of those funds that I just went through?
Would you explain a little bit the large balance in the transportation fund compared to last year?
Large balance in the transportation fund compared to last year. I would say.
Oh, I see. It's lower this year than last year.
It is.
June 2015, there was almost $1 million in there. Now there's $128 million.
Well, that year-over-year comparison, that's how much more is in this year than there was last year.
Okay.
So you were right with your first statement. I would say just overall expenses have been lower in regards to the bus repairs and the fuel and things like that. That we've got a really good locked-in fuel rate, and helps save money from there, unless Ted knows something that I didn't think about or anything done.
Unless it's a bus purchase.
And that would come from the bus replacement fund, and that wouldn't be transportation fund. So.
But with the bus replacement fund, we will see that change as we get ready to order those two buses. And then you will see that in that rotation. But a lot of it is just trying to cut expenses across the district and be very much diligent of everything that we're looking at and spending money on.
Yeah, if you look back over the last 6 months, only, you know, two of them have been closer in the 70,000 range between February and May. So overall.
Now, last year, did we buy two buses and the Z, is it Z2 that we're calling it?
Yes.
And, okay, so we bought one last year than we're buying this year.
Right, and mind you, that's from the bus replacement fund versus the transportation as well.
Thank you. You're right. Thank you.
Sure.
Okay. Any other questions? Not a motion to approve the financial report.
So moved.
Okay, motion by Brad.
Second that.
And same by Steve. Any other discussion? All in favor? Right. Okay, motion carries 6-0. Thanks, Val. Student stakeholder focus donations. We have Polk County Solid Waste District, Columbia Soda Machine Recycling, $300. Polk County Solid Waste District, RMS, 15 to 16 recycling participation. $500. Polk County Solid Waste District High School Environmental Club, $500. Rochester Community School Corporation Retirement Request, Nora Hudkins Robotics Team, $50. Rochester 500 Club, RMS volleyball uniforms, $1,300. And Clay's floor covering for flooring and interior, Lazy Boy sofa and low seat for RMS letter lounge, approximate value $5,000. Are there any others?
Nothing.
In addition? Okay. Any questions? It's on the motion to approve the donations.
I move that we accept these very generous donations from our community.
Okay, motion by Lisa.
Second.
And a second by Sandy. All in favor? Okay, motion carries 6-0.
Tom, I know we do this every time publicly, but I'd like to thank again all those people who donate, because it sincerely is appreciated not only by us, but the kids and the community. So for all those who do donate, thank you.
Yes. So those little things that help out a lot, like that.
Just like Mr. Hawes is getting a Lazy Boy in the love seat, too.
Yeah, we need to monitor that.
Yeah.
I guess I'll have to stop by and make sure they
function. Make sure it's in the lounge.
There's a camera in that room, isn't there?
There will be.
Yeah. Okay, we'll move on to information analysis. Food service changes.
I've invited Kathy Wilkinson here to speak about food service, the prices that we need to charge adults as well as the students. I don't believe the student prices are changing.
No.
But if Kathy, you could share just a little bit about the reasons for the changes in the adult.
Okay. When I applied this year for our lunch program, the state did an average weighted analysis on our prices. Student prices do not need to increase, but adults need to increase from $275 to $290. So I recommend that we raise it to $290 if possible.
And reiterate, student prices are not going up.
No. Student prices, we were within 14 cents of student prices, so they do not need to raise.
Is there a number that triggers a change then?
Yes. We have to average the cost of a paid student's meal plus the 6 cent certification that we have, and then the weighted price of our commodity. And then once we put all that together, then it has to be 60 cents above that for the adults.
Anybody else have any questions?
Yeah, I do. 16 cartons of milk in a gallon, I believe. The 8 ounce cartons?
Yes.
That's $6.40 a gallon. Is that because of the packaging for all the little cartons? Or?
Yes.
And so that's our cost, basically?
It cost me 29 cents a carton. Okay. So in order to sell it at an a la carte price, I have to justify for that. So
we have to sell it at a different price because it's a la carte?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Is there any way to get around that? I know it's only 11 cents, but.
Seems like such a staple.
Right.
It just doesn't seem right that we slap an a la carte price on it. I'm not saying you're doing it, you're following regs evidently.
Correct.
But I just don't agree with the reg, I guess, that would be an extra fee because it's an a la carte, but it's milk. So, anyway.
Don, I would throw in there, and I know I sound like the Grinch, but and we do have to pay for refrigeration to keep that milk, you know, safe. And we have to pay people to serve it. And
I agree with that. As long as we're covering our costs to the bare minimum and not making a profit, then I don't have a problem, in my opinion.
Right. But well, how many cents were we talking? Or not?
11, I think.
11 cents.
Yeah. Per carton.
But this 40 cents down here is a la carte.
Correct.
That's for extra milk.
Correct.
Yeah.
Okay. They get one in their lunch.
Yeah, they get one with their lunch or their breakfast. It's for extra. And I know that because Amber always has a bunch for that.
That we can't serve.
We can buy a cow.
Yeah. I certainly don't disagree with charging what we need to break even. But just the reg because it's a la carte. Anyway, thanks.
Okay, any other questions? Now I need a motion to approve the school meal pricing for the 2016-17 school year.
I make that motion.
Okay,
I'll second.
Second by Lisa. Any discussion? All in favor? Hey, motion carries, 6-0. Thank you, Kathy.
Thank you very much. We don't get to see you all that often, but I want to tell you that the feedback has been so terrific since you've taken them.
I'll second that as well.
Yeah, it really, really has, and that's really fun to hear. We enjoy that.
South Florida, Columbia, is that what I heard?
What?
The cell, my 8-year-old's all enthused about it, but I think that's wonderful.
Okay. Request for bank proposals?
I believe it was in January, we met with Brad Weaver and Steve Schaller as part of our financial committee to look at that as we moved into the new calendar year, not school year, but calendar year. And at that time, it was decided that we would reach out to all of the local banks. Umbaugh and George Bockham from Umbaugh helped us with those agreements, those types of things, getting all of that information. And then Valerie and Julie and I believe Brenda sat down with one of the entities where the bids came out the highest. So I will let Valerie share all of that information and that recommendation.
Through looking at the proposal or the compilation of all the the requests for proposals that Umba had provided back to us, it was really clear. There was just one bank that just came out with quite a great investment piece in comparison to all the other banks, and that one was Teachers Credit Union. And even their fees came in lower for the things that they did charge, and then even their interest rates came in very much higher than compared to the other banks as well. And then when paired up with our average banking balance that we have, with currently our investment ratio, it just came back so much better that I was intrigued. So the ladies and I have invited them to Teachers Credit Union members of there's three members that had come in and given us more information, as well as a tutorial of how their website works, if and when we would decide to go with them, how we'll look on our side for functionality and pieces like that. So we were able to meet with the local branch manager, as well as two other banking representatives in the area as well, who handle schools and municipalities and are familiar with them. One of the things that throughout this whole process, kind of putting it out there, sharing what we were looking for, and then receiving back the tally compilation side-by-side analysis, the Teachers Credit Union came out so far ahead. It just started putting pieces together in my head where I had been coming from Union North Schools, that's Marshall County. Well, Teachers Credit Union had just won the RFP process, this banking process for Marshall County as well. So that speaks some pretty good volumes in my head, as well as a couple other schools as well that they had given me references for working relationships. So we've not found anything, or at least, and I've even gone back to one of the representatives from Teachers Credit Union and asked them, how can you offer these great rates? And they said it was because of their investment strategies of that they're a credit union, they are accredited, we can work with a credit union as a school entity, and just because of their diversification of investments that they're able to offer that notch above interest rate with notch above service.
And on that note, correct me if I'm wrong, this was offered to any local bank here in Fulton
County.
Exactly. We want to make sure all local banks are offered.
And that was the goal of working with George Bockham, with Umbaugh, is to take the political stigma out of it and just make it fair and literally a side-by-side analysis.
Well, our community invests 7S, we would give them the opportunity to do the same in return.
Exactly.
So I want to make sure people knew that we did offer it to, and if I'm wrong, please tell me, but we did offer that to every bank that has
bank
a
in town.
Facility in Fulton County.
We offered it, every single bank in town actually, except for one, declined to respond.
But that was their choice.
Exactly, yeah. And they had communicated that, and that's the only reason why we knew that they had declined.
And I believe, Valerie, correct me if I'm wrong, but for us on the investment side and the returns, it would mean about $32,000 or $33,000 that we would gain over what we have in the past in regards to that return.
So that's our recommendation, is to accept the proposal submitted by Teachers Credit Union tonight.
Sounds like a very good recommendation.
We did our homework.
Yeah. Any other questions? Can you need a motion to approve adopting the banking relationship with TCU?
So moved.
Okay, motion by Brad.
I'll second.
And second by Lisa, any discussion? All in favor? Right? Okay, motion carries. Thanks, Byron.
Thank you.
Okay, moving to change in the pay periods.
As we look across the district, we talk to each of the building level principals and administration about making sure we're doing everything we can to cut costs and not get into those overtime hours. And as they were doing that, we started to really look at what we were doing at central office as well to make sure that those that we were trying to lead by example and cutting as much of that overtime as we could as well. In that, we found that one person consistently had overtime, and she knows that we're talking openly about this, but when we sat down with her to try to get to the bottom of why that overtime was, it had to do with when time cards came in and then the turnover that we have to do in order to make sure that the funds are ready to go into everybody's individual accounts, direct deposited, and that turnaround time was just so high, and that is considering that she's never going to be sick or never going to be absent during that time. So with that, we began to look at a revised payroll date and trying to do it at a time when it would least affect and impact employees across the district. And I know that it does as we go through this rotation period, but it is a sincere effort to try to reduce our own overtime hours at central office. So there is a revised payroll date that we were proposing that would help eliminate not all, but a huge chunk of those overtime hours that we're seeing at central office. And by doing that, I think we will cut back tremendously how that works within our office, but it's an effort to reduce overtime and save money.
Ms. Vance, was there also a benefit that Teachers Credit Union gives us now another day by using the...
That would be part of it as well.
Okay. Any other questions? If not, we need a motion to approve the change in pay periods.
I move that we change the pay periods okay. As described.
Motion by Steve.
And I'll second it.
And second by Lisa. Any other discussion? All in favor? Okay, motion carried 6-0.
I would like to thank you all at Central Office for working on that one and being so creative and trying to find ways to save us some money.
Well, thank you to those. I know it impacts. We tried to find the time when it impacts the least, and I know Candy's one of those, and so you try to do it when it least impacts, but overall, it's a sincere effort, a good faith effort to make sure that we are doing exactly what we're asking each of the buildings to do, and that will take that overtime tremendously down at our building.
Good. Okay. Faculty staff focus, personnel report. We have hiring Sharon Pan Sickle, Riddle Instructional Assistant, Teresa DeVise, Columbia School Nurse, Kelsey Hollenball, first semester temporary health and PE teacher, Jessica DeVise, Columbia Instructional Assistant, Family Medical Leave, Kathleen Felke, first semester 2016-17. Resignation, Michelle Vader, Columbia Special Education Teacher. Are there any additions?
Yes, there's
an
updated version before they.
There's an updated, we had a Chinese teacher.
I printed off the first one. Okay, we've got hiring Bethany Rohr, Middle Special Needs Instructional Assistant, Emily Williams, Middle Special Needs Instructional Assistant, Brenda Eber, Middle 8th Grade Careers Course for High School Credit, and resignation of Olivia Lay, High School Chinese Teacher.
Did you get this one?
Yeah, Michelle's. Okay. The motion to approve the personnel report.
I move we approve the personnel report.
Okay, motion by Don.
Second.
And second by Sandy.
All in favor?
Okay, motion carries 6-0.
And Jason, I believe the new Columbia nurses here, if you'd like to.
Yeah, absolutely. I'd like to introduce you guys to, if you've never met Teresa, this is Teresa DeBeese, and she graciously came to tonight's meeting because I'd like to put her name with a face for everybody. We're extremely excited to have her. She has a lot of experience, not just in nursing, but also working in our corporation, and she's kind of been a substitute nurse for us on several occasions. She's worked in classrooms, and we're absolutely thrilled to have you on board. Welcome, and this is for everybody to know who our new nurse is. So.
Great, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Welcome.
Okay, the approval of contract addendum amounts.
As of what you have approved each of the people within the position, and there are some on this list that have already been approved. I know that Luke and his amount was approved before, and also Greg Marks has been approved, but others on this we need to go through. I would respectfully ask that at this time I have not had a chance to talk with Michael Rohr or to go through the ending evaluation with Dan McCarthy. I think our schedules have kind of bounced back and forth, but would respectfully request that the others be approved, and I can go through and read each of those if needed. Are you done? No? Yeah, we won't put them up because there are some changes that we have pulled. So Luke Bernacki is Riddle principal with 220 days. The contract amount is $70,180 with the contract of 2 years that was approved at a previous. Julie Calvert as the deputy treasurer, 260 days. It's a 2-year contract for $39,520. Skeeter Doherty has already been approved. Dan Funk as network administrator, $52,846, 260-day contract with 2 years. Val Gillespie, business manager, $60,000. It's a 260-day contract with 2 years. Oscar Haas, RMS principal, $75,739. It's a 230-day contract for 2 years. Chris Kiesling, RHS assistant principal, $74,287. It's a 230-day contract for 2 years. Scott Kistler, director of technology, $64,200, 260-day contract for 2 years. Greg Marks was approved at the prior board meeting. Dan McCarthy, I need to sit down and go over contracts with. Pat Mellinger, Director of Student Services, $72,446. It's a 220-day contract with 2 years. Cassie Murphy, RMS Assistant Principal, $62,033. It's a 205-day contract with 2 years. I need to sit down with Michael Rohr. I apologize. I was out a few days for a family wedding and need to catch up with a couple people yet. Jason Snyder, Columbia principal, $78,540. It's a 220-day contract for 2 years. Adam Strasser, RHS principal, $89,065, 240-day contract for 2 years. Jim Swank, director of maintenance, $54,777. It's a 260-day contract for 2 years. Brenda Troyer, human resource administrator, contracted amount $40,400. It's a 260-day contract for 2 years. Myself, the superintendent, $104,751. It's a 260-day contract for 3 years. And Kathy Wilkinson, food service director, $46,569. A 230-day contract for 2 years. And again, I apologize. I just haven't had time to catch up with a couple of them as our schedules this summer have not met up.
Okay. Any questions?
As the board recalls, these are 2-year contracts. The second year of the contract, except for Mrs. Vance, it's a 3-year contract.
Excuse me on a note, Mr. Wager. Is it Mrs. Vance or Dr. Vance now?
It's ED. I have my EDS. The doctorate, the topic has been proposed, but I have to finish
okay. That.
This one makes sure.
Jen Anderson.
Okay. Yeah. If it was Dr. Vance, I certainly was going
no,
there.
Not quite okay. There yet.
We're close.
Yeah, you don't have all that work ahead of you.
I apologize for the interruption, but no, that's important to me.
Right. The second year would be at the same amount or increased. These come up every year, future years, so you have an opportunity to either extend the contract leave the contract as it is and let it expire after a two-year or three-year period. But every year we go through this and the numbers either change or don't change depending on what the board wants to do and what the negotiations with the employee result in. So.
I move to approve these contracts, days, and amounts, and the years.
Okay, motion by Don.
I'll second.
And second by Lisa.
You need to acknowledge Mr. McCarthy and Mr. Rohr in the motion.
She did as she voted.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, you'll approve them in the future.
Very well. Right.
Yeah, I'll have those next month. I need to get with them. It's solely my taking a few days off for wedding.
It's not your fault. I was out camping and swatting mosquitoes.
Yeah. We tried a couple of times.
I could skip the mosquitoes. We got a hurt contract. I might have chosen that.
But we will get there by the next month. We'll finish those up.
Any other questions? All in favor?
Was there a second?
Yeah.
I second it.
Sorry. Motion by Don, second by Lisa. Six or? Yeah. Thanks.
Six or 12, maybe 11.
Okay, moving on to other business, the shared service agreement of a school psychologist.
In an effort to defray cost, not only for Rochester schools, but with other schools, we are really starting to reach out to each other and anything that we can help local districts with shared combined services is something that all schools, especially the smaller rural schools, are looking into. Donna Burrow, superintendent from Triton, and myself, along with Pat Mellinger, our special services director, are very much interested, and thank you to Ted Wagoner for helping us draw up this contract, to share our school psychologist with Triton. It would require her to travel to Triton one day a week. Triton would be paying the cost of her mileage, the round trip mileage there, to help defray that cost. And Triton would be paying Rochester Community Schools the sum of $16,067.88 for the 36 days that we would be sharing her. Should Triton go over those 36 days, it would be an additional $446.33 per day. In excess of those 36 days. Donna Burrows has shared with her board, if you will note at the bottom of this contract, it does say that each superintendent needs to verify with the board and make sure that everybody understands what that means. But again, it would be a cost savings to us. It would help another rural school district make sure that they have those services that they need. Would respectfully ask, we believe that this is going to work for Rochester. Triton is confident it will work for them. We want to make sure that we reserve the right. Mrs. Bodie had come to us on a four-day contract. This brings her to 3 days at Rochester, one day with Triton. We have spoken very openly with her and just want to make sure that our students and kiddos are not jeopardized in this process. So if we talked as an administrative team today, if they see any concerns, if we're not making those or meeting those needs of the students, I would respectfully bring back to you that we would bring her on for that fourth day here and continue to honor this agreement with Triton.
Okay. Questions?
And Mrs. Bodie is on board with that.
She understands that. And I've talked to Mrs. Mellinger as well about making sure that those lines of communication continue to stay open. And if there's a sense of being overwhelmed, if there's a sense from the administrative team that we're missing something on our end, then we would possibly be right back here at this table suggesting to you we need to pick her up for that fourth day here while still honoring Triton's contract.
And this is an annual, just a one-year contract?
Correct.
For the upcoming school year. Okay.
Can we approve that so at the discretion of Mrs. Vance, if she needs that fourth day, she can approve it? I mean, we don't need to micromanage this either.
Right.
So can we make the motion so that if Mrs. Vance decides that she needs that fourth day, she can do it without her consent, or she already has her consent, or is that just looking too far down the weeds?
What you're doing is you're giving her authority to enter into the shared services agreement for the betterment of the school corporation. So you're giving her the...
And maybe the board doesn't want to do that, but that's something we would have to address in the future then.
Yeah, well, she has to have that if she's going to sign this. We set it up. The size of the contract is not such that it's a serious concern for either school, but obviously we need to have both school boards on board with the shared services.
So need a motion to approve?
I move that we accept the shared services agreement with Triton.
Second.
Motion by Lisa and second by Brad. Any other discussion? All in favor? Motion carries 6-0. I'd like to thank Mrs. Vance for reaching out to local schools in our area, trying to find ways to save money and work together and make some of these programs work, which some of the smaller schools may not be able to afford on their own. So if we all work together, you know, we can have some mutual benefits. So like, thank you.
Yeah, well, thank you. And we talked as an administrative team today about those decisions in regards to smaller rural schools. And just to share, I was going to share at the end of the meeting, Amy Rowe, who was a former Rochester grad and is now the executive director of the Chamber of Commerce, has organized four Fulton County superintendents. So Cindy Douglas, Brett Boggs, and myself will be sitting down with politicians tomorrow afternoon to really take to them specific numbers and how it affects and impacts us here directly. And I know I've shared hundreds of times and probably everybody's tired of listening, but just in the 2 years that I've been honored to be in the seat, our funds have been cut about $260,000, and that's huge over a two-year period of time when you've already made as many cuts as you could. And when Valerie opens up an email and yells down the hall that Title I is cut by another $40,000 just by opening an email. So we had a really good heart-to-heart discussion about what that means for Rochester and how much we want to do to help other schools but maintain our longevity and our financial security. And I think it was a good conversation and ones we will continue to have. And you're looking at four gentlemen who said we will open our doors and do whatever we can to help out those other schools while allowing them to maintain their own identity. And that's one of those first steps. I would appreciate if we were in a like similar situation that they would return that as well. So trying to reach out but maintain individual identities while being fiscally responsible. And I believe we're going to see more and more of this unfold in the next few years.
I'd like to thank the administrative team too for working on this. It takes extra time and effort. Appreciate it.
It's a good group of gentlemen there in that front row.
Okay, construction issues and action on portable classrooms.
Terry Thornsberry is here, and Terry, I appreciate, I was talking to the board in study sessions and everything, and I think sometimes things get really difficult to handle via email, and there are a lot of questions and concerns, and I shared with Jason Snyder today as this is going to impact his school mainly, and we're trying to get Luke a solid foundation there, and then he learns that Riddle's going to go through a building project, and so he kind of had to absorb a lot of information this morning, but was very open-minded to it. So I know that there are a lot of questions, and at our last study session we talked about everything from utilizing the learning center to the possibility of purchasing private property to what this can look like for the school and do the best that we can with bond monies while making sure that the students get the education that they need and that we get the project launched as needed, but saving as much as we can in the project. So Terry, I know there were multiple questions, and I would invite this just to be open conversations back and forth with Terry. He's done a wonderful job, and hours of communication between the two of us that it's going to be kind of consolidated here. But
okay, so I'm basically, Janice filled me in. I'm here to answer questions, try to help guide you guys through this decision. So is there anything in particular you want to discuss or go through?
Let's start with the portable classroom conversation. Okay. It first began as we were looking at bonding the project, if I recall correctly, some conversation about that. There was a proposed contract from IMS, I think it is.
IMS, correct.
Who is one of the local contractors, local manufactured building providers here in Rochester. And they sent a proposed contract that provided for portable classrooms at Columbia for a two-year period but it was my understanding that we were going to, in fact, move the classrooms over to Riddle for the second year when we do the Riddle project. But that raised some questions with the board when the prices came back in. Why don't you go from there?
Okay. So back in December, we reached out to four different companies to say, okay, we have this upcoming project or two projects in Rochester. And at the time, it was mostly just Columbia. We were talking about Riddle at the time.
Can I interrupt for just a moment? And that what brought us to the portable classrooms was knowing and working with administrators and having conversations about whether or not we could house this within our own district, which when it became not educationally sound or feasible to handle it within the district, Adams is a totally different situation in that we can rotate and do those things. It became very problematic at the elementary schools because of room, the age of the students, those types of things, which brought us to the portable classroom conversation. And the conversation I had with Terry is, please reach out as locally as we can to keep the funds here.
And the portable classrooms will be used to empty a classroom.
Two classrooms at a time,
so that the classrooms can be stripped of their current heating, ventilation, air conditioning systems and have those replaced over
2 weeks.
2 weeks. And then those kids will go back in their classroom and they'll move another couple classrooms in.
Right.
And we'll just work our way around the Columbia School Building.
And speaking with learning leaders and with technology, we also wanted to make sure while they were in those portable classrooms that we didn't lose professional time, that they had the same benefits as the students sitting in the building within those classrooms. So we wanted to make sure the smart boards were there, that the Wi-Fi was there, that everything was available to the... Yes. So then that, I apologize, that brought us to the portable classroom. So there was a little bit beforehand that Terry and I had spoken about to make sure that we were on the right track and we had exhausted.
One question maybe to start on the, comparing the time of the two buildings. So at Columbia, we're gonna go into the room and completely tear out the old units, and it's gonna be a brand new system. But then at Riddle, it's just, the plan is to clean them and...
That's been done. That was finished. Jim Swank took care of that this past summer. And he's documented and given us the information to make them better to get us through the summer. And so far, I've heard no issues, right, especially this past couple weeks.
Right.
We would know if we were still dealing with some issues humidity-wise. So the cleaning of those units has been done. But the intent actually is to completely renovate Riddle as well. We think we're gonna have the money to do it. We'll know better tomorrow when we get the high school bid on the mechanical side to see where we stand. So back to your point is the reason we need the classroom is because we don't have any flex space, as we call it, inside the building. We need to be able to shift two classrooms of kids somewhere else. So we can free up two classrooms to allow the contractor to come in and renovate two. You swap those kids out, then you move to the next two. You work your way down the hallways to get all the classrooms taken care of. It's 2 weeks roughly of work in there. So we're given a 3 week window per class, per two classrooms. That gives us time to do our inspections, that time us to do our commissioning work to make sure things are working the way they should be. So it's a pretty quick schedule. For Columbia, construction starts Monday of next week. So we're kind of behind the game right now because we don't have a trailer in place, which we had hoped already have in place. But our intent is to do Columbia first. If the funds are still there for in the bond to do Riddle, we'll do Riddle the exact same way, the complete renovation of the HVAC system. We went ahead and had Columbia cleaned, or Riddle cleaned, so that you didn't see the issues that we saw last summer, see with that humidity and just some of those things. So Jim Swank was able to show me pictures, and what they found was pretty amazing. I don't know how they worked at all. The units, they were completely clogged up. So he had those cleaned, and so far so good. I haven't heard any issues from him whatsoever. And I've been in the Rubin buildings, and I haven't noticed the humidity being as bad as it was. So we knew going into this, we didn't have any flex space. It was dealing with Janet and others within the school system to say, okay, what are our options? Can we shift kids out in the classroom or out in the hallway? Nope, they're already out there. So there's no room left in the hallways. Can you shift them to the gymnasium? Nope, that won't work because you need the gymnasium. So there was no extra space. And going back to Dan Ronk's time, we actually talked about adding on buildings and doing other things, knowing that this was coming. So in December, we reached out to four different companies. We got two responses. We got a response from IMS, Innovative Modular Solutions, and we got a response from JobSite Mobile Office here in Rochester. So in December, January, we met with them. We gave them a basic outline of what we wanted. We wanted a trailer that would accommodate two classrooms with a centralized entrance and then egress out of those classrooms. That's pretty standard for the classroom trailer industry. Pretty basic. They all make the same, roughly the same size, the same amenities, the same features. We got a ballpark number for them. We needed it for the bond to say, okay, how much do we need to plug in for this classroom? We roughly plugged in $100,000 and said, okay, that's a placeholder. Now if this becomes reality, we'll reach back out to them and say, okay, now we need a contract. We need an actual floor plan. We need to see all the specs for these buildings. We need to know what's going to happen. So we got to that point finally just a few months ago, reached out back out to them, and IMS said, no problem. We can make this work as long as we get things rolling to get this trailer made for you, because we have none sitting in the yard. We don't have anything sitting around that we can use. JobSite responded back and said, we're too busy. There's no way we're going to get this done. And so they backed out. So we continued to move forward with IMS, and we were able to, they actually went ahead and produced a trailer for us, even without a contract, because they said they'll use it somewhere if they didn't use it for us. So they went ahead and built it based on the specs that we needed, which let's think in as a standard for the industry. And so the sheet that I just passed around shows that option, that new trailer, is option one. So the cost breakdown's on there. Roughly, we're talking about $124,730 for it to be at Columbia for a year. So there's an option to move it to Riddle if we decide to move it. But in talking to Jana, there's an option of leaving it there instead of busing kids over during those 3-week periods and trying to save that cost, because the cost to move it to Riddle is $76,000. So if you total those up, though, that's a little over $200,000. It actually equates to $100,744 per building. So our budget number was still good. There's just more money up front to initially bring it here and get it on campus. That trailer is actually manufactured by Modular Building Incorporated here in Rochester. So you're supporting local business and using their trailer. Now, since we started the process with IMS, they actually had a trailer that got freed up, an older one. And they said, well, we can refurbish it, and it has restrooms in it, because that became a discussion with Jason. Can we get restrooms in this thing? Can we make this work? There are a couple, two more things you have to deal with if you have restrooms: water and sewer. And those aren't pipes that are laying on the ground, because we're talking about going through a winter. So they have to be buried in the ground. We have to tap into those in the closest location. Stepping back one step, as far as the location for this original trailer, we had kind of placed it back earlier this year and said, okay, it'll fit here. And then we started to go down that road and realized the new fence is up right where our trailer is sitting. So that was a hiccup. And you want it within the secure area within the fence. So we met on site, found a way to only move a little bit of fence that's already up to locate it in one spot. Gets it inside the secure area, gets it in a place that's not near the playground so that you're not disrupted to the classroom. We looked at a lot of different things, and this is kind of the only space that it'll fit. So going to then option two, this one with restrooms in it, two things. We don't have sewer or water right there, so we've got to figure out how do we get it there. And that could, going through a parking lot, it could be, I don't know, we haven't even figured out where the utilities are. Because there's another issue, is that we just have enough room to fit it between the entrance into that parking lot on the west side and a storm drain that's in the grass. And this other trailer's 2 feet longer, and we're gonna be on top of that storm drain. So we can't put it there. And IMS, they can't get it level and flat, because that grade drops off really fast at that drain. So we'd have to find a different location, and as you know from our walkthrough there, that puts it back in that area that you didn't want it next to the playground. It's only big enough space to put it.
One of the areas was right off the basketball court, which I'm sure you can imagine trying to have class while we have, you know, 150 kids out there with basketball hitting that building. And, you know, we're trying to maintain that, you know, classroom environment just like it would be in the regular, you know, quiet and all that. And that just wasn't, that out by the playground just wasn't a good area for that. The other spot that we had looked at was outside of what I call the wire, the fence, and there are obvious safety concerns with doing that, not just during the school day while we have students there, but also, you know, after school and so on.
We even considered that open vacant lot across kind of catty corner from the school, and that created its own problems in regards to Wi-Fi and electric and all of those things.
Yeah, it was really
fun. Its current planned location for option one, it's close enough that we can accommodate everything. Kids can go in and use the restrooms. We're very, very close to the door. So it's a little bit of inconvenience that they have to go out. But it's each of those two classrooms is for 3 weeks. So they only have to do it for that 3 week period, and then they won't have to do it again. Option two, the issue is now it will not fit where we plan to put option one, even though it seems minor. That 2 feet's a big deal. I went out and physically measured all of it, and we squeezed it in there, because we also have to have egress out of the back of the trailer and around it for safety. So we can't take up every square inch of space. And relocating the fence and all that wasn't a huge deal. Jim was able to get that started. But you have a new gate that's going in there, and we can't move those gate posts. They're big, they're concreted in the ground, and so we're just squeezing in between all that. So option two, if you decide to go the way, that trailer has to be renovated because it's old, and they want it, before they give you anything, they want it in like new condition as best they can. So that would take an additional 2 weeks to get that trailer ready to go before they can get here. We're already talking probably 2 weeks plus just to get option one here based on schedule. So that would put us probably 4 weeks out or so before we'd see that trailer. The cost is $113,863, so it is less expensive than option one. But again, it has the restrooms, and the cost that we're missing here is, what's it gonna cost to get the pipe from street to that trailer? And that's missing here. So, and we have to have that engineered, approved by the city, and go through that process. And again, that's gonna take a while. So it is less expensive, but you're missing those two things of getting water and sewer to the trailer.
Terry, what was that total again?
$113,863.
Does option number one have water and sewer?
Does not.
No, it does not.
It does not have restrooms. They would go inside to use the restroom.
Terry, you said that under option one, the building would be closed, or the portable building would be close to the main building, so it'd be easy to get to the door and the restrooms. Yeah. Is that okay with the fire regs if the buildings are so close together?
We have to be within a certain distance, and we meet the requirement by being that close. And in fact, we can't get much closer without being against the building.
Well, I thought it couldn't be too close because of fire regs.
No, I'm saying it's well within the distance we need to get to that door for the code. But yes, we're not too close, that it's an issue. What I'm saying is there's really no room left to squeeze it any closer or further back to make this work. It's just perfect for what we need, as long as everything goes just the way it should. So we're working around a light post, a storm drain, a curb, a street, a fence. But we're able to squeeze it in that one spot and put it where he needs it so that it's not disruptive to the class in there. So, and it was important to do that, and I'm glad we spent the time, Jason, to go over do it, because you brought up some great points. That trailer guys, they're the ones who said, well, let's just put it there. Well, it works great for them, but it doesn't work great for the school. So.
And where exactly is this spot?
West side, so it's the west side where the back parking lot is. Mm-hmm. There's that small little I guess, the enclosed playground area that's there on the west side of the building, but it's that adjacent to that parking lot. So I don't know what door.
Right out the first grade doors.
First grade doors?
Yes.
Okay.
Kind of an unused green space that would work well.
Okay.
So there's those two options, and then some information was passed along to me about a refurbished possibility of an existing trailer, a larger one, that Quality Setters has. So we investigated everything with that, and that trailer actually is from 1997. So it's was actually built under different building code than we're currently under. It was FOCA, was the old code up to 1998, and we're now under IBC. So the building isn't up to code that we're currently under. It also does not, they do not own the, have possession of the state designer lease, which is required for us to set this building. City's not gonna let us set the building without a state designer lease. It doesn't exist. Or we found out that it was manufactured by Forest River, Belcart. Forest River no longer builds these trailers. So, and we've seen pictures only of it when it was taken down. And we don't know how long ago that was. We don't know anything about it. And it's damaged on the inside, so there's some things they have to fix. There's some things that have to be done. But we have seen no current pictures of it. The cost for that one is about $107,000. $107,150, but under that third bullet point, it does not include decks, ramps, stairs, electrical service, plumbing, fire alarm permits. It doesn't include anything that option one and two includes as a package. Basically, with IMS, we tell them where we want it, we're done. They take care of everything. With this one, you guys would have to provide a 600 amp electrical service to the trailers, distribution panels, and all those other things. And so that 107 number grows really fast. Plus, the trailer's 20 feet bigger in one direction and 2 feet bigger in the other. And I don't know where in the world we would put it. It has five different restrooms in it, and, two classrooms that are usable and one small one. So, we don't even know if, even if we can get this old state designer lease, if the city would allow us to sit it there because it's not built to the current building code. And if you end up having to then pay to refurbish it and get it up to code for fire alarm and all those other things, you're probably going to be well over the number of the other two options.
Tim, did you have a question?
Yeah, I'd like to explore another option. Why do we have to buy it?
You're not renting it.
We're renting it? So $175,000 is a rental cost for 1 year?
$124,730 is a rental cost for the trailer.
Okay. Who's are your guys doing the work? Your subs?
No. No, it's all through IMS. IMS takes care of all of it. I'm just, as the architect, helping facilitate this.
Okay, so you're just renovation. So does this IMS, do they have plans to run multiple shifts since it's inside work to cut down the time frame?
The new trailer's built. They just have to come and set it, hook it up.
I'm talking about inside a classroom. Can they, if they're inside working, can they work two shifts and cut the time in half?
Oh, you mean within the building classrooms?
Yeah.
Those, the people that are doing the Columbia?
Right. We put a plan together based on the number of classrooms and all the auxiliary spaces within the building, and it's going to take 9 months based on the current schedule we have. And they bid it based on that schedule. We didn't bid it doing double shifts or extra hours or any of those things. If we did that, that cost would go up. We were already at $2.5 million just to renovate Columbia for the mechanical system. So we were trying to get as much out of this as we could, spread it over a 3 year period from when we started earlier this year, be able to do the roof on the high school, which is done, the high school, Columbia, and then there's enough money left to do Riddle as well and get all the mechanical systems in three of the buildings updated with the potential of a separate chiller system for the middle school as well. So I'm trying to just get the most out of that money and make this work. If we double up shifts and we do those things, you're gonna pay a premium because you're gonna pay overtime or time and a half, because union contractors don't care. They work 8 hours at night, then that's time and a half. because it's not 8 to 5. So if you want to think of it that way.
The option A, or option one, $124,730. That's the total price for 2 years.
2 years, I apologize, correct.
Mrs. Vance, if you don't have an answer for this, that's fine, because I didn't warn you. But do we have an estimate for cost, if there's any additional cost for getting the kids who are going to be at Riddle over to Columbia instead of at Riddle, they have to be taken to Columbia every day. Is that going to be an additional cost?
That would be some cost in regards to the drivers and transport back and forth, but not nearly.
Enough to make it up. Yeah. Okay. All right.
Terry, let's say we go with leaving it at Columbia with plans on bringing Riddle kids over. Can we budget at the end of that first year, decide, hey, this isn't going to work, let's go ahead and move it? Yes. Would that be within the budget?
You're not paying that 124 up front. You're okay. Paying, there is a lump sum amount to set the trailer, $62,000, to set it, hook it up, have everything done, and then you start paying a monthly rent. And you only pay that as it goes along. When the time comes that we say, okay, we're going to leave it here, then you just continue to pay that rent. If you decide to move it, then it's an additional $76,000 to move it over to Riddle and reset it. The reason why is because we have to put foundation systems under this, we have to get electrical to it, we have to get the fiber and everything else to get it operable. And they have to physically move it down the road.
And in fairness to Tim's question as well, we looked at the option between leasing and purchasing, and then knowing that if we purchased it, could we build some type of coverage to attach that to the building? And that became,
That's not really an option. And I talked to the city about the option of, can it be a temporary building for 5 years? Technically, no. They can, she said we might be able to push it for 2 or 3 and leave it there, but they have to start signing paperwork on their end to allow us to keep it there, because it's a temporary building. But we have to meet building code and everything as if it's a permanent building. So it's just the foundation systems and those things that you think about it, you can't just set a trailer there and storm comes along, which you guys get some hefty ones sometimes, and nothing blows over because it's not strapped down. You can't do that. It has to be strapped down, it has to be anchored just like a permanent building. And so you're gonna have concrete in the ground. They're basically piers, and then that'll be then anchored to the bottom. The trailer's basically got a big steel frame under it, and that then gets anchored to that concrete, so it's not going anywhere. That also keeps it stable, so that we put the ADA ramp on the front and the two stairs on the back and go through a winter, and we don't have to worry about things moving around too much.
I think you answered one of my questions. It will be piers, because originally I thought it was going to be a slab, then what do we do with the slab? And so piers would be...
Yep, and the piers will be at grade, and basically they get left there.
Yeah.
They don't tear them back up. So.
I think in fairness to the public that, we just looked at the total cost initially of $170-some thousand, and it's all picked up and taken away, and we keep nothing, and we had a little problem with that. So that's what led to this whole discussion.
Oh, absolutely, it's a fair discussion.
And so that's caused the keep it in place, bring the students over. And we also looked at, can we build a couple classrooms? And that's really expensive. So basically, we're down to this, and this is just something we have to do.
We in our industry consider the cost of construction, because sometimes you have to do this because you have no flex space at all. And we've done this before, and we've dealt with it before, because you're out of room. Long term, bigger picture is, you're still going to be out of room, even when this is all said and done. You're going to have a better building, but that's why we started discussing additions to these buildings a few years ago and looking for the future. So that's a whole different thing to deal with. So, and I agree, it's hard to see those dollars being spent and this thing disappears and what you get out of it, but you freed up those classrooms so the construction process can happen. So there's just no way around it.
Jason, thoughts or ideas? Anything you
want to
add?
I think Terry covered all the areas that we had discussed. We just, we tried to look at the placement to be the least restrictive for the students, the safest, the easiest for them to get into the buildings. know, they've got a, they'll be going back and forth to those classrooms quite a bit. Trying to keep it inside the wire, so.
Yeah, the ramp will come down exactly on that sidewalk, right beside it, so there's, we don't have to deal with anything other than their install of it and being able to get to the building.
The kids will think it's a grand adventure.
Yeah, back in my day, that was the church trailer day.
I have a question. If, Terry, if they're not going to move that, if that move is going to possibly take a year or more later from now, is that $76,000 locked in, or a year from now, are they going to say, oh, now they're more?
Yeah, there's a 7 or 8 page contract, and I brought you an updated copy of it.
So even though it's a year or so later, they wouldn't?
They don't change it. And we, and even though we ended up with only IMS, Lynn Smith in my office worked for Whitney Manufacturing, who does this for 20 years. She knew where the costs needed to be. Plus, we still had that number from the beginning when we were talking to two companies. So they didn't raise their price. They could have tried to take advantage of it, and they don't want to. They did have somebody, now a week and a half ago, contact another school system who wants that trailer, and they really don't want to give it to them because it's going to be, it's a lot more challenging project. It's harder to get it to them. And you're in their backyard, and they've been holding it for us. And but they told us today, because we asked them this afternoon, when can you install it, when can you be ready to go, and they said, and they're up to the point now, you get us a signed contract and we'll talk to you. They're kind of getting exhausted. We call them every day, mm-hmm. and try to get this information and make sure that nothing's changing, there's nothing we've missed. We find typos in the contract and we get them to fix the typo. And so it's a little bit of babysitting, so. So yes, the location is right there. You can't see the fence isn't on there because it's an older aerial, but basically where you see that pointer is about the fence line. So we're gonna move that fence back up to the north a little bit and towards the street. But you see the light post that's right there? So the ramp's gonna come out right next to that and just go onto that sidewalk. So the kids will come around, head toward the building, and then go through it. There's a couple different ways they can go in. They could go back through the gate and back into the other door. But there's a gate there on that sidewalk where the fence cuts across east and west. And then you'll have a motorized gate.
There will be a gate.
Correct. There will be a gate, and there will be a motorized gate back there. So there's a stop sign, a light post, a storm structure, and we're squeezing it all in that spot. Originally, we talked about putting it back over on the east side. We've talked about different things and down to the south and there, and then also back over to the east and the south there around the trees. But the fence cuts through there, and sound-wise, that trailer isn't soundproof by any means, and it would be noisy in the classrooms. And we talked about, because at that age, they get to go to recess a couple times a day, and it's noisy. So this gets them the furthest away from the noise and kind of out of the way in a safe spot. So, and then putting the trailer inside the fence will hopefully minimize any chance of vandalism or anything else.
We've also got camera footage on that wall over there. So that was important to us to have that, to be able to see not only during the school day, but also after hours.
So we tried to find our best options, and the site's driving part of it. Trailer size is driving a lot of it. As you see, there's just not a lot of real estate there. There's
what are the dimensions of this?
68 by 28. Yeah. I have that. Oh, I can get a copy. That's 68. It's two units that are.
Jenny, is this our insurance company? Are we covered? Are we going to have to add this to our policy?
It's already under construction. We carry construction.
We'll be all right. Yes.
As far as the restrooms, I guess this, since it's only a 2-week inconvenience, that's not as bad as if one class had to be in there all year.
No, so. We talked about trying to do that, and in order to do that, you'd have to have flex space, and we don't. And so, yeah, unfortunately, didn't like the idea of moving the kids back and forth and back and forth, but there's just no way around it.
So now the teachers are all rolling dice to see who can be there in August and September and not January and February.
Well, that and they're going to be nicer than their classrooms. So they're going to like those trailers. So all new finishes and all new everything. I mean, it's already equipped with tack boards, dry erase boards. We're going to use your smart board to put in there. Then we need a projector in the ceiling, but it's all wired for it. So.
All furniture will be moved out of the classrooms into the trailer.
What we anticipated would be maybe you'd have two different changeovers to where you'd one size classroom, and then once the kiddos get up to the little older, would you change? I don't know. I haven't looked. I haven't paid attention to the size of the tables and the chairs and where that transition takes place. I remember sitting on them at teacher at conferences where I'm sitting on them.
Yeah, we're gonna look at every grade level is a little different based on what their needs. Kindergarten, you know, has some small short tables. First grade has some desks. Our first rotation, we're gonna try and take the students' actual desk with all of their materials out there, so they have their own desk and all the materials. We're going to try that for a cycle or two, and then if that becomes an issue or if it's taking too much time to move that stuff or other issues arise, then we'll get a classroom set of desks put in there, and then the kids will have to take their stuff out. But we're going to try that first method first and see how that goes.
Terry, correct me if I'm wrong, kind of back to Tim's question about overtime and double shifts and everything. They are coming 4 days a week.
10-hour shifts.
Working 10-hour shifts, which will also allow our employees, our custodial staff, to make those rotations within the classrooms on that Friday, three-day weekend, to not put us into those overtime and bringing them down and trying to help on the cost savings on that as well. So they're working four 10-hour shifts, allowing our custodial staff to make those rotations, teachers to make those rotations without putting us into overtime as well.
Yeah, because they're offsetting their cost by doing 4 days because they're not traveling the fifth day. Kern's out of Fort Wayne, so. Timing right now is essential because construction starts Monday. The pre-construction meeting is Thursday morning and construction starts on Monday. So they're going to start staging, they're going to start setting equipment over there, they're going to, and so that trailer, we anticipated the trailer already sitting there, so that classrooms were set up, and when school started there was, so now you're actually going to have kids that'll have to start in the classroom and get moved to that trailer.
So, but in fairness to the board, I respect the questions and the conversations.
Absolutely.
And they haven't been privy to all the hours and hours that we've spent. And I think you too. It's just hard when you spend hours and hours in conversation and the communication. So I apologize as well. I commend the board. They're doing their due diligence. Unfortunately, they don't have all of those hours of time that we've communicated. So, and I will do a better job of that in the future.
You do a great job. But we hadn't been walked through all of those alternatives and why all those other things wouldn't work. And just like you, we had some serious sticker shock for something that, you know, we could use. We could buy something with that much money that we could really use and enjoy and for the betterment of the kids. So that was a jagged pill to swallow. So I appreciate you then walking us through why all those other things that we were shouting out these ideas, why those things wouldn't work. So
and I would have.
It's still not an easy number for me, but I get it.
Yeah. The city, had the city said, Terry, we'll let you keep it there. We understand the school's overburdened, and you can keep it there for 10 years. Then I'd say we would have all put the classroom, we would have put water and sewer in there, and we'd find a place to make it a home, because you need it. But she said, absolutely not, I can't. She goes, I can only do so much to where we can keep pencil whipping this form and saying, okay, we'll just ignore that it's over there. They wanted to make sure they saw what it's going to look like. They care about this because they don't want the community saying they've got some trailer sitting over here, and you know, they were really concerned about it, which was good that they care and they don't, and they make sure that we're doing what we're supposed to be doing on our end. So. And IMS has already been in contact with them, so everything's ready to go. We just need to move forward with the contract and then be able to schedule it.
Does anybody have any other questions or concerns?
When personal, we're just supposed to be good stewards of people's money too, so that's why we ask, and I'll leave it at that.
And it's tough, but I just don't, I wish we could find a way around it.
So what departments, what people gave whatever variances so we could put the portable building there?
It isn't a variance. You're allowed by Rochester's ordinance to do this. The second year, they're going to have to extend the paperwork. And so technically, we're not allowed to do it for the second year unless they...
So that's a city council thing there?
We already got it approved. I deal with the city on a daily basis, and so she's being real flexible with us. It's Casey Cowell. She's...
Well, I'm just looking at who to thank.
Oh, Casey.
Yeah, okay.
Thank commission.
For us, thank you.
Yeah, yeah.
She's the one who's...
So, okay.
We help her out. She helps us out. It's a, okay. It's a good relationship, so...
I just would like for us to acknowledge that that was needed, you know, it happened.
Yeah, they understand what we're doing, and they understand you're improving your buildings and making it better, but she was absolutely against keeping it long-term. So.
Okay, any other questions? Do we have a recommendation from the board?
I recommend we go with option one. Make that motion. I guess I can't make the motion. We go with option one. Is that the one you recommend, Terry?
I do, because it's sitting somewhere here real close.
It's ready to go.
We start Monday.
It's somewhere.
Then I make the motion. We go with option one.
Second. And I'll be there Monday.
Motion by Brad, second by Sandy. Any discussion? All in favor?
Thank you.
I'll get Valerie that contract.
Okay.
I just need a scan copy.
And we'll send it right over to Ted. So.
Thanks, Terry.
Thank you, Terry.
Thank you.
Okay, down to superintendent business.
Just very quickly, I already mentioned Amy Rowe. When you see her, if you can thank her as well on behalf of the Fulton County superintendents and rural schools and what we're trying to do to reach out and share with them on a more personal level. We want to be able to take them through some of our budgets, some of those expenses, see the buildings, those types of things. So she has done a tremendous job helping us open those lines of communication. We actually met just about, probably right about a month ago with Glenda Ritz, the state superintendent, and that was arranged by Amy as well. So she is really rallying around the school and getting the community to understand the impacts that those voting decisions we have, how that impacts everybody as a whole. So a thank you to her. I want to thank everybody for the registration, that common registration and the hard work that went into that. We spent some time today as an administrative team talking about the good, the bad, the ugly, and how we can change that and improve that moving forward. So I appreciate everybody's hard work in that and their honest attempts to better that situation. And as we've shared before, it's not necessarily the best for every person in this room, but when you look at the community and making sure that we're servicing those families, I've heard some really good things. So a tremendous thank you to you for those efforts and for your honest answers today and making sure we can improve that next year. And then finally, organizational day is next Tuesday, and we're starting those lines of communication, and school is next Wednesday, believe it or not, the end of summer. It will be a late start Wednesday day for the kiddos. It will give those teachers and administrators one last time to talk and communicate and get everything ready. But also, quite honestly, I didn't see bringing students in on a Wednesday on the regular time and then switching that on them later. It causes a great deal of confusion. So we're going to start with that late start Wednesday time. Teachers will be under contract. They'll start at that regular contractual time and give us just a little more time to gear up before they take over the building in the hallway. So that's all I have.
Jana, are you going to do a school reach?
Yes. Yeah. Well, it's set to go out this Friday. And then a sincere thank you to the administrative team this morning. That was one of the best meetings we've had, I felt, in a long time. And their honest answers and their approach to some tough philosophical questions, I think, are going to drive the district in a different direction. We haven't really had a chance to sit with you, but I need to pull those ideas into personal goals as well to share with you. And but it was a great conversation and a great launch to the school year.
Thank you.
God bless Luke's heart. Yeah, he's just hanging on for the ride, ready to go.
Sounds like a superintendent we had a couple years ago. Oh, here's your new job, and by the way, we're going to do all of these building projects. So good luck with that.
We need him to be nodding his head on camera that he's on board with this building project.
Did we tell him about this before?
I'm pretty sure he knew everything going on.
Okay, Brad.
Real quick, feedback on registration, guys. I know for me, three different checks to three different schools, or I know that's frustrating for parents, but I found out there's three different accounts. I know there was some frustration because, but you guys will get through it. I was told there's bumps in the road and we'll get through those, like needing copy machines, and I hated the duplication effort. But any feedback from parents besides me? I love the one-stop shop, but it didn't know. I don't know if it saved time. What did you guys hear?
I heard positive comments from parents that they were happy to come to one building, not have to make three or four separate trips.
I heard a lot of positive feedback. I think the things that we did hear that maybe were a little more negative were just, our first time doing it, easy fixes.
I would encourage you guys to listen to your staff on some of it, because this is the first time they had some great suggestions that would save me filling out three different pieces of paperwork too. But that's a learning experience.
We talked about that a little bit today. Greg had a really good point with athletic side, the physical or the information, the health information was duplicated, and Scott had some ideas about contacting Harmony to eliminate some of those duplicated processes. But to pull, Jason had the idea about making sure parents had folders to kind of organize everything in, because it seemed like when you're all in one building, you get a ton of paperwork from each of the buildings. So those were things, I don't have the list in front of me and I apologize, but we went around and did the good, the bad, the ugly, and we've got that.
Because I know for us, we update our demographics of each of our children, and it's like, why can't we just go off that way? That's for another time. I'm sure the administrative
Scott talked about that today. We talked a little bit about the transportation part of it, not having to duplicate that process. One of the reasons for that with transportation is we just rolled over to a new system to expedite the route, especially with intersection and those things, the stumbling blocks. So we had to get all of that inputted for one time and can just go through and edit from there on out. But yeah, absolutely, there are things we talked about.
No, I was just going to say that and this is for every building, our secretaries and our support staff that came in and ran that, they did a fantastic job for the first time doing it, and new location for three buildings and just working together, the high school staff, everybody just came together, and we're real grateful that support staff was able to do that. They really led the...
Since Terry's here, if the air conditioning had worked, it'd be better. Especially for us Husky guys. Three kids in tow.
I mean, in all honesty, the success that we had in that, all stemmed from that.
Was there much wait time for parents at any?
It was on Wednesday. There was...
I think the biggest wait area was in the library, where Mr. Kistler and his crew deserve extra vacation days or whatnot. But that was because of Harmony's new family access system. Had nothing to do with anything that Scott and their guys were doing, but Harmony switched on us, so we had to update all that information. I'll be honest, the best feedback you're going to get is if you sit the two ladies behind me, Mrs. Zent and Ann, down and let them tell you, because that's kind of their baby, and they did a great job with the adjustments, and there's definitely growing pains with everything, but I think there's a lot of positives from the community, and we can adjust these buildings to make it work as we move forward. But again, I know this is the second time publicly I said it, but Mr. Kistler and his guys, they busted their butts the week before, and then the day after registration at the high school, they had the four ladies set up to 8 o'clock appointments the next day, so
thanks,
they deserve a lot of that.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Ms. Vance, do you have anything on attendance numbers or enrollment? What do we look like?
We talked a little bit about that today. We know enrollment is up at Columbia for certain, especially in the kindergarten area. I think Luke shared that third grade is up. Oscar says sixth grade is maxed out. Adam's still waiting to take some on at the high school. Valerie and I were looking at preliminary numbers. They would be a bit higher than our predicted numbers that we turned in the spring, which I believe is a testament to Rochester schools and the leadership and what we're trying to do here and reaching out to families and to students and providing the best that we can. So our numbers are definitely growing, and that will take us back to what Terry spoke about a little bit earlier. The numbers are growing, and where's that line when we go ahead and take that big step forward? But numbers are up.
Gym floor is beautiful.
The gym floor is absolutely beautiful. Don joined me over there to see that, and Adam sent me pictures when I was in Tennessee and shared, and I think he used the word awesome and cool and big print and sweet. So we're excited to open that up to the public as well. So thank you all.
That's good. Yeah, I think anytime you change something like this, there's growing pains. It's going to get better. You just learn and learn ways to make it better. So thanks for all that work.
Yeah, the feedback I got back was good. People, mm-hmm. people with multiple children were happy to only have to go one place. I thought that was great.
As long as we give our staff the support they need with copiers and things like that. So they can make me so I don't have to fill out something three times. It was my first time registering. I went just to get
that. Well, you were going to have trouble no matter what.
I know. We all have my intelligence level. So.
Kids in school for 18 straight years. I don't know how I feel.
Oscar teased me, I sent Doug through to register Dryden, and so we got that. I had to have those conversations with him as well, the good, the bad, the ugly, so.
The good, the dads, and the ugly.
Yeah, we'll work on it.
Okay, anything else from the board, any questions? Anybody in the audience, anything to say?
I'm excited about this year, it'll be a good one.
Yeah, it's hard to believe school's starting again already, crazy. Good luck this year.
Yeah.
If there's no objection, we'll adjourn the meeting. Thank you for coming.